Heavenly Father, Almighty God, this morning as I bring your message, I ask, Lord God, that you will touch my voice, you will touch my heart, you will touch my attitude, you will touch my spirit. Lord, that anything that reeks of Janet will be decreased, and all that reeks of you will be increased. Lord, I pray that those in the hearing of this word, that something that is said will resonate with their hearts and will resonate with my heart, that our lives, O Lord God, will be changed as a result. Lord, I give you thanks for what you are about to do this morning, what you've already done, and what you will do in the future. We thank you. I give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, I've titled my message, Down to the Wire, But Are We Ready? Down to the Wire, But Are We Ready? The phrase down to the wire has its genesis in horse races. No, I'm not a horse racing fan. And what used to happen, a wire was often hung across the finish line in order to help determine the winner. This was especially useful in races that were very close towards the end. Thus, as the riders approached the finish line, they could be described as coming down to the wire, quite literally. When we survey the scene right now, we can say that we are approaching the finish line of time. We are getting down to the wire. The signs are all around us. The conflict in the Middle East, the proliferation and acceptance of ungodly and abominable practices. And the Bible has outlined for us in Matthew 24, what are some of the signs of the last days? Two Saturdays ago, I was awakened from my afternoon nap by the phone ringing. It was my sister in the Lord, Patrina, calling to break the news of the death of a fellow brother in Christ who was a worship leader. I exclaimed in shock. Subsequent to that initial call, I spoke to two persons, one of whom was at the church that Sabbath day when the call for help was raised after the service. The other person spoke about conversing with the brother that said very day. Person number one then sent me the link to the service that day. At the beginning, I could see the brother who was working on the media trying to get things organized. Little did he or anyone else know in that assembly that he was approaching the final stages of his life here on this earth. After receiving the call, I telephoned another church sister and asked her if she had heard the news, and she was part of the worship team. She hadn't. And when I told her, she too reacted with shock. After putting the phone down, I cried. See, death is nothing new, but this one was a very stark reminder of the frailty of life. I thank God for being so merciful, but I also asked him to forgive me for my sometimes apathetic attitude, for the times when I was not as passionate as I ought to be, for the times that I was lethargic in doing his will, for the times that I could and should do better, but did not. I want for my message today, which is entitled Down to the Wire, But Are We Really Ready, to really sink in. And I've taken as my text today, Matthew 23:13-33, and a very familiar portion of scripture, Matthew 24:2-14, and 42-44. So I'm looking at Matthew 23:13-33, and Matthew 24:2-14, and 42-44. I will not read the portion of Matthew 23 in its entirety, but will make reference to it later. Here is what Matthew 24:2-14, and 42-44 say. And he said to them, "Do you see all these things? I assure you and most solemnly say to you, not one stone here will be left on another, which will not be torn down. While Jesus was seated on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately and said, tell us, when will this destruction of the temple take place? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end, the completion, the consummation of the age? Jesus answered, be careful that no one misleads you, deceiving you and leading you into error. For many will come in my name, misusing it and appropriating the strength of the name which belongs to me, saying, I am the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed, and they will mislead many. You will continually hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not frightened, for those things must take place, but that is not the end of the age. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. But all these things are merely the beginning of birth pangs, of the intolerable anguish and the time of unprecedented trouble. Then they will hand you over to endure tribulation and will put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of my name. At that time, many will be offended and repelled by their association with me, and will fall away from the one whom they should trust, and will betray one another, handing over believers to their persecutors, and will hate one another. Many false prophets will appear and mislead many. Many lawlessness is increased. The love of most people will grow cold, but the one who endures and bears up under suffering to the end will be saved. This good news of the kingdom, the gospel, will be preached throughout the whole world as a testimony to all the nations, and then the end of the age will come. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. So we also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when we do not expect him. When Jesus delivers this discourse, he has just left the temple area. His disciples call his attention to the magnificence of the temple buildings, but Jesus warns them of impending doom in verse 2. He says, do you see all these things? I assure you and most solemnly say to you, not one stone here will be left on another, which will not be torn down. Can you imagine that the majestic beauty of the temple being admired will one day be destroyed? Let's think of our most treasured belongings. One day, they too shall be no more. Prior to this, in chapter 23, Jesus has pronounced a series of woes on the scribes and Pharisees. Now, we all like to condemn these group of leaders along with the Sadducees as self-righteous. But the question I want to ask of us today is, how closely do we identify with those we are condemning? You know, they say when you point a finger at a person, three more are pointing back at you. For each woe, Jesus addresses the groups as hypocrites. Now, a hypocrite, as we know, is a person who says one thing but does something else. Jesus prefaces his summation by saying, the religious scholars and Pharisees are competent teachers in God's law. You won't go wrong in following their teachings on Moses. But he warns about following them. They talk a good line, but they don't live it. They don't take it into their hearts and live it out in their behavior. It is no wonder they are described as hopeless frauds. Jesus' woes speak to the following, and as I relay them, let us think of whether we, not somebody else, but we ourselves, ever fall into any of the categories. First, their lives are roadblocks to God's kingdom. They refuse to enter and won't let anyone else in either. Their words and behaviors are not congruent. They don't match up. Persons like these are stumbling blocks in the lives of those destined to the kingdom. Can we identify as such stumbling blocks? What would our family members, neighbors, co-workers say about us? Would they say, if this is what the kingdom of heaven is about based on your behavior, I'll pass? Or, your behavior speaks so loudly I can scarcely hear you? Or would they warm up to the idea of having what we claim to have? Secondly, they use eloquent and long prayers as a cover-up for misdeeds. There are some individuals who, when they pray, they are the epitome of real prayer warriors. But at the same time, they have some serious skeletons of misdeeds in their closets. They are mean to family members and friends and have intentionally wronged others without seeking any sort of forgiveness or repentance. Thirdly, they all go to convert someone and then turn them into further damned replicas of themselves. They say that people who lie down with dogs will catch fleas. We are instrumental in winning others to the kingdom, but our questionable lifestyle, coupled with our close association with them, instead of pulling them up higher, tarnishes them further. Fourthly, they make promises, but they don't keep them. These religious leaders would pick and choose what constituted a meaningful promise. Swearing an oath on the Bible was held in higher regard than giving your word or shaking a hand in agreement. One should not be less meaningful than the other. Our word must be our bond. Fifthly, they are meticulous about keeping records on tithing, but they forget about fairness, compassion, and commitment. People will always remember how we make them feel. Being compassionate, committed, and fair speaks volumes. I can hear the echo of 1 Corinthians chapter 13 now. If we speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, we are only a resounding gong or clanging cymbal. If we have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if we have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, we are nothing. If we give all we possess to the poor and give over our bodies to hardship that we may boast, but we do not have love, we gain nothing. Sixthly, in essence, they look great on the outside, but inside they are filled with greed. Being a speaker of the word and not a doer, it's like spitting up in the air and allowing the spittle to come back into your face. We should not judge a book by its cover, nor should we be expected to be judged solely on our external appearances. At the end of the day, what's on the inside is far more important than what we portray on the outside. Seventhly, Jesus doesn't mince his words. He says, they're so good. They think they're so good, but beneath the skin, they're total frauds. Could someone say that about us? That's a real sobering thought. And finally, there is also an ambivalence about generational influence. Sometimes we can be caught up in generational sins and not even be aware. Breaking the cycle is key. These religious leaders are regarded as hopeless, with little, if any, chance of getting into the kingdom of God if they stay on that trajectory. But the question today is, can any of these descriptors be attributed to us? And if so, what can we do about it? You see, we are coming down to the end, down to the wire, and we need to be ready. First, we need to acknowledge that we have these shortcomings. Then we need to tell our Heavenly Father that we are truly sorry and we want to change and become all that he would have us to be. 2 Peter 1, 5 to 11 is a great guide. Excuse me. The NIV version says, His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. That's verse 3. And verse 4 says, Through these, He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. Jesus has given us everything that we will need to get to the wire, to make it to the finish line. But we must be prepared to seize it with everything we have. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, mutual affection, and to mutual affection, love. The writer starts with the premise that we all have faith. And here I want to interject to say, I admire Sister Angela's faith. Sister Angela may have told me about 2 months ago she wanted me to deliver today. Never once did she call or message to remind me. Now that is great faith, expecting that I will remember. And I did. Each one of us has been given a measure of faith. And as we traverse life's journey, we are to add 7 other components. And if you know anything about 7, it's the number of completion. Goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, mutual affection, and love. That's one component for each role. Each component is stated simply and in self and is self-explanatory, I believe. Doing what is right, knowing more about God and His character through reading His word and gaining knowledge, keeping our cool under trying circumstances, not giving up even when the battle is hot, being godly in our walk and our talk, being kind to others and showing love to all, and I stress all, those we encounter. The author further explains that if we possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep us from being ineffective and unproductive in our knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. The choice is ours. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort. Let us make every effort to confirm our calling and election. For if we do these things, we will never stumble, and we will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I like how the Message Bible puts it. So don't lose a minute in building on what you've been given, complementing your basic faith with good character, spiritual understanding, alert discipline, passionate patience, reverent wonder, warm friendliness, and generous love, each dimension fitting into and developing the others. With these qualities active and growing in our lives, no grass will grow under our feet. No day will pass without its reward as we mature in our experience of our Master Jesus. Without these qualities, you can't see what's right before you, oblivious that your old sinful life has been wiped off the books. So friends, let us confirm God's invitation to us, His choice of us. Don't put it off. Do it now. Do this and we'll have our life on a firm footing, the streets paved and the way wide open into the eternal kingdom of our Master and Savior Jesus Christ. Verse 13 of Matthew 24 offers us the motivation we need. But the one who endures and bears up under suffering to the end will be saved. While verse 44 gives us a word of caution, so you also must be ready. So we also must be ready. because the Son of Man will come at an hour when we do not expect him. Our brother went home to be with the Lord while doing service for him. Let this be a lesson that we must not shirk nor draw back, but we must go forward strongly and boldly. We are getting down to the wire, and we've got to be ready. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, I thank you, Lord, Holy Spirit, for speaking through me. And I pray, Lord God, that as we've heard this word, it would have ministered to our hearts. And that, Lord, where there are changes need to be made, that, you, Lord, we would allow you to make them, O Lord God. And we would allow you, Holy Spirit, to guide us and to lead us so that we can truly make our calling and election sure. So that when you, that we are ready, whether you call us home before you come or whether we are still here when you put in that appearance, that we will truly be ready to be received unto you and to hear those words, well done, good and faithful servants. My brothers and sisters in Christ, I thank you.